Hi, I'm Richard Weiss, former president of the Explorers Club, and I'd like to welcome you to the Explorers Club 50 lecture series. If you're new to the club and to the lecture series, I'd like to welcome you and tell you a little about ourselves and also about the Explorers Club 50. First of all, the Explorers Club was established in 1904. At that time, by a bunch of guys trying to get to the North and South Pole. And since that time, our members have covered just about every corner of the earth. In fact, when you walk into the lobby of our historic headquarters on the Upper East Side of Manhattan, there is a plaque on the wall that perhaps summarizes it best. Our members have been the first to step foot on the North Pole, first on the South Pole, first to stand upon Mount Everest, the highest point, the first to go to the lowest point in the ocean, and also our members were the first to go to the moon. Other notable explorers have been Theodore Roosevelt and Jane Goodall, and just about every notable explorer of the 21st century. Now about the Explorers Club 50. The slogan is 50 people who are changing the world that the world needs to know about. And I'll give you a little genesis of how that started. Last spring, during the beginning of the pandemic, one of our members said to me, you've got to check out this performance or this video called Earthrise by a young poet named Amanda Gorman. I watched it and it was about the Apollo 8 mission, which were our members. And I was blown away by how she described Earth, the environment, and the fragility of our planet. We started a short correspondence and became pen pals. She became a member. But I also thought, how many other Amanda Gormans are out there in the world? In fact, when I got together with the chair of this program, Joe Rohde, who you'll be meeting in just a few minutes, you know, we got together and we said, how do we want to describe exploration in the future? And if we're truly a global exploration society, then our club has to represent the world as we see it. And not just in terms of how people look, but also how people describe the earth and the sky and just about everything in science. So how did we choose the EC50 honorees? 50 people who are changing the world that the world needs to know about. The first thing Joe Rohde said to me was that if you take a problem and you approach it with the same people, you are always gonna get the same type of result. So he immediately said, we wanted as diverse a judging panel, people who could look at the world through a different narrative and lens and be able to come together with some sort of conclusion. So he put together a group that was from all over the world. The next thing we had to do is have our membership give us people that they have met along the way that were doing incredible things that maybe weren't recognized for their work. We got about 450 nominations. And I have to tell you, they were pretty amazing. We could have gotten an EC 200 out of it. We came out with our top 50 honorees, and the result was nothing less than spectacular. We have people covering all sectors of disciplines from space to paleontology, oceanography. We have Inuit, Native Americans, Americans, Sri Lankans, Indians, Africans, and just across the border. So this is the inaugural lecture series, and we'll have a few more that'll be rolling out over the week. But in the meantime, I want you to sit back and enjoy some good old-fashioned storytelling.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of our Explorers 50 Conversations. This one is grouped around the theme of storytellers, and we have an extraordinary group of storytellers to talk to. But first, let's hear what they have to say about themselves.
Myself is Avijan, and I'm from Siliguri town, which is very, you know, small town and situated under the West Bengal state of India. So I'm living in a small country, a small town, which is very close to the Himalayan region. And my home is totally based on the Himalayan region, the Himalayan foothills, actually. So here in my area, I found the several the rich biodiversity zone, especially for several faunas and floras are there. So I've started my career as a journalist in a local channel, and then I entering in a wildlife line, because I during my journalism career I found that wildlife are mostly suffering issues right now and most highlighted topic right now. So I started this topic in my backyard. Okay, from my backyard actually. So when I my Siliguri town is very close to Indo-Nepal border. In this land, in this photographic slide, you can see the two river, right? One is called the Mechi River, the left one, and the right one is called the Balashan River. So here is the in between the area, which is called the Tarai landscape. Okay, so this is a part of the Tarai landscape. Tarai actually the vast landscape, the part of the Tarai landscape here I mentioned in that particular slide is mostly the wildlife concentration area, especially for elephants. So I've started my career to understand, to study them, study the elephants' behavior, study their route, study their migration pattern and all those things. So that started from my backyard, because when I started my career, I found that elephants are the most suffering species. And every single day around one elephants that died, and one people are suffering or one people are died by the elephants. This scenario is very common in entire world right now, not only India, but Africa and other country where elephants are staying. So here in Tarai landscape, in our internet, before I go to the slide, I also want to mention that in entire North Bengal area, which is under the west part of West Bengal, and the foothills situated inside the foothills of the Himalaya, in entire North Bengal area, there is two part, which is one is called the Tarai, another is called the Duars. Duars is the northern eastern part of the landscape. And if you go to the western part of the landscape, which is called the Tarai. So here in Tarai area, you can see there not only the forest, but there are so many tea gardens, human habitations, rivers, army areas, so many things, which is called the mosaic landscape. And the most problem that elephants are facing there, the migration, because elephants don't want to stay particular forest areas, but they want to move from one forest to different forest areas, right? Here, in our entire landscape, there are two species. One is the elephant, another one is the leopards. Both are suffering, both are using that landscape, and both are depends on human reproductive, you know, foods and all those things, right? So I am focusing the both animals. Why elephants are using that landscape? Elephants needs to move, and they wants to move from one forest to different forest, and so they are using their you know, the regular route. But the problem is when Nepal government are using around 17 kilometer fence to block elephants old migratory route in Indian part, right? So the Indo-Nepal border has started the problem, and the part of the North Bengal are suffering with that problem. That fencing around 18 kilometer, which was inducted by the Nepal government in 2016, has totally blocked the elephant migration route. As a result, they're scattered in different part of the landscape, and you know, people are suffering, mostly the tea garden peoples, because tea gardens are the only choice for elephants to move frequently from different areas, right? So tea garden peoples are suffering because tea garden peoples are mostly depends on crop cultivation, especially paddy, maize, and all those things. And elephants are came for that crop. So that's why I go for the next slide, because in that slide, you can see the large elephants, the herd are gathering for crop cultivation. They're attracted by the crops, mainly in paddy season in winter and in maize season, mostly on monsoon. So in winter and monsoon, large elephant herds are gathering, and they're totally depends on crops. So because crops are the most nutritious foods that attract elephants and profitable for their physical characteristic also, especially the bulls. Bulls are depends on totally, human man-made foods like rice, paddy, and all those things, vegetables, and other things also. So that's why bulls are mostly suffering, right? Here in that landscape, you can see the bulls and you can see the large herd because most are the suffering. And I think that apart from the paddy and the crop season, the elephants are also suffering with so many challenges like the highways, railway lines, tea garden, army areas. And that also because the entire landscape was fragmented. In our terrain landscape, the entire landscape is fragmented area. This forest patch is very minimum, right? So if I go for the particular reason to understand the elephant, that is that because of the fragmentation of the landscape. And that's why elephants are suffering. And most of the challenges they are facing with humans too. And by time, we understand them because elephants are, adapting the humans every single day. This is the same scenario. You can see people or elephants are standing in particular frame and both are adapting themselves. Elephants are adapting human and humans are also adapting elephants, right? So this is the thing that I have realized that in my landscape that nothing can stop elephants, especially the challenges. Every single day they are adapting the challenges and they are used to by their own characteristic. The another species which is much effective in tea garden areas, that is the leopards. And leopards are mostly stay inside the tea garden area because of the physiological character. Like I say about the leopard, their height is much easier for shelter inside the tea garden, right? So here you can see the leopards are standing sitting beside the tea garden tea bushes, and that height is totally matched. That's why they are focusing on tea gardens. And another reason, they can easily approach the human productive foods like the cattles. Here you can see tea gardens, the cattles is the most attractive for leopards, right? And the reason I told you that same particular person have at least 5 to 6 cattles. And last month they have the only one cattle which was lifted by the leopard. And finally, forest department was able to catch the leopard, the victim leopard, and released it to the other part of the forest, right? So as a cat behavior, we know that particular leopard came back to the same spot after a few days. So these things are introducing leopard and produce them as a most of the they are very much dependent on the human foods and they are very much adapting creature, elusive and nocturnal. The thing is, last one, that is I found that few tea garden leopards are collected one leopard cub from a tea garden and they're send it to the forest department. But after a few days, the particular leopard was died because they was removed from the own land. So here is the thing. We have to understand that one leopard is very much effective for the land and there depends on the mothers also, right? So these things that leopards and elephants, both are depends on human, human productivities, their foods, their behavior, and their characteristics are totally depends on people's understanding. That why people like human, like man-made peoples from tea gardens area, people from village area. So they are producing so many, foods, attractive foods, which attract the leopards and elephants too. And that causes so many conflicts every single day. Thank you.
After one lifetime spent assisting filmmakers in Hollywood and around the world, in 1998, I began to tell my own stories on film. I started
with the story of growing up in the Arctic on Baffin Island between two very different cultures, Inuit and Kadlunad, who are settlers or white people. My upbringing gave me the language and the access to tell the story Songs in Stone. Some of my favorite sculptors from that early period are still selling their work through the co-op in Cape Dorset. Each has developed an unmistakable style. This winged shaman just has to be Lukdas.
Lots of imagination.
Big, think. They used to be small.
Shamans used to call together the world of animals and the world of people. Now Lukda does this in his work. He's always been shy, a watcher, a man of few words. On a rainy day, I found him looking after his grandchildren. I can't remember ever hearing the word colonialism when I was a kid, but today I see how Inuit and other indigenous people are struggling to regain the sovereignty and self-determination that we stole from them. Many say, the damage is done. What can we do today? My choice is to make amends through films like Kiviuk, for which I partnered with Inuit elders and youth to tell a story long forbidden by our Christian missionaries, the story of the ancient shaman Kiviuk. My most recent film celebrates the success of Nunavimmiut, the Inuit and Cree of northern Quebec, Canada. They created cooperatives to get out from under the boot heel of colonialism, as personified by fur traders like the Hudson's Bay Company.
Hello. when the traders came north, at first we thought that we would benefit from their goods, but there were only a very few men who were successful in trapping enough fox to keep up paying for what they were getting used to, like tea, tobacco, coffee, sugar, and flour. If you didn't catch enough foxes, don't expect any credit from the store.
It's almost like that's when Inuit and the Cree were made to really feel poor for the first time.
My father used to mention that they were treated like second-class citizens. Mm-hmm. The trader had the upper hand.
Thanks to Joe Rohde, Lacey Flint, and all at the Explorers Club for providing this opportunity to share. Thanks also to Jason Edmonds at Adventure Canada for nominating me. And thanks to you, my fellow EC50 members. You inspire me to do more, to push the exploration further. Anyway, that's the plan.
Hello, everybody. My name is Latonia Hartery, and I'm an archaeologist and filmmaker living in St. John's, Newfoundland, Canada. And today I'm going to share a story with you about my research in northern Newfoundland, and I've called it Culture and Livelihood in Northern Newfoundland. So to start us off, I'm just going to situate us and tell you where my project has been based. So I've been working here in northern Newfoundland for the last 20 years, outlined here by this yellow pin. And the name of the town that I've been working in is Bird Cove. And it's directly in northern Newfoundland in the Strait of Belle Isle region. And because it is in the northern part of Newfoundland, it really is hit head on by the Labrador Current coming down from the Arctic, a cold ocean current. So the landscape and the animals, everything that is available in the weather is very Arctic-like. So here's sort of a close-up. If you look, this is northern Newfoundland here. Bird Cove is this red dot. Here is a Google map of the town proper. And this part called Dog Peninsula is also within the municipal boundaries of Bird Cove. And 5,000 years ago, when people first started living here, this peninsula actually was a series of islands because the sea level was about 5 meters higher. And this is what attracted people to the region, the chance to live along these sort of coastal islands, to have consistent access to ocean-going resources. Here's the town of Bird Cove today, and the archaeological sites are represented by these dots going across the screen here in this panoramic view. There's 18 archaeological sites in total, most of them on the peninsula, but some of them on the current mainland part of the town as well. Now, the origins of our project actually have sort of its beginnings oddly in the death of the cod fishery in Newfoundland and Labrador, or the moratorium at least, in 1992, because this was the economic mainstay of the town. But when the cod fishery collapsed, local people had to look to an alternate source of economic income in a way to generate economic stability. And that's when they turned to archaeology. And they turned to archaeology because places like this peat garden was where people used to get blocks of peat to put in their own gardens to enrich the soil. But every time they would do that, they would realize that when they would turn over the sod, there would be very funny looking rocks or peculiar looking rocks that they figured belonged to people who had lived in this area perhaps thousands of years ago, because obviously it didn't look like anything that, or any kind of tools that anybody was using there today. And so when this the fishery died, and with this realization, the community started to partner with academics and professional archaeologists who came to the town to test and assess the archaeological sites and put a bigger project into practice, all the while collaborating with local people and training them also to be people who would work in the field. And over the course of the last two decades, the project really has hired about 300 seasonal workers off and on throughout the years. Now, through that collaboration, as I said in the beginning, people have been living in this area for 5,000 years. And here's just an example of something that we have found together as a group. These are end blades, the tips of harpoons for hunting seals used by indigenous people, known as the Dorset Pre-Inuit 1,500 years ago. But the archaeological sites as well are not all that old. There are some what we would call more recent historic, such as these beaches here that have been carved, trails that have been made for people to walk along the beaches and dry fish over the last, you know, hundreds of years by people such as the Basque and the French. Once the unique collaboration between archaeologists and community got out about 20 years ago, because the project really got on its feet in 1998, we started to receive tourists from around the world who would also interact with local people, which I think brought a lot of joy to this particular region, in addition to all these wonderful things that we were finding and the research questions that we were posing. Due to the out-migration of the people in the area, the old school actually had no children to put in it anymore to educate. So it was converted into a museum, and then people also trained locally to be museum interpreters to talk about the things we have been finding over the last 20 years. Similar thing for the craft shop. They started a craft shop in this museum and used their local talents to create quilts and other crafts to actually put in the shop, to be another sort of source of income for the museum and also for the town. Same thing can be said for infrastructure. A lot of people locally actually created things like boardwalks and trails that enable tourists and also people who live in the community to access the archaeological site. So this was all done in-house. It wasn't farmed out to consulting firms or bigger construction companies in the area. One of the great things about the project and this local genesis of it and collaboration is people like Dale Kennedy, who first was one of the first people in the town to have this idea to use archaeology as a tourism cornerstone, I guess, of the economy. And he actually won the Pendergast Award, which is the highest accolade, I guess, a avocational archaeologist can receive here in Canada. And in addition to sort of people like Dale, there was also an incredible place for elders in this project because their knowledge was essential to discovering the archaeological sites, but also, you know, for understanding how the land and the landscape worked in general. So people like Elva Spence has been with the project since the beginning. And she's also someone who teaches us a little bit about how to live life and enjoy life, but quite critical in looking at some of the old maps and determining historically and in the pre-contact period where the most intensive form of land uses probably would be, which highly correlate then to the location of archaeological sites in the pre-contact period, but also in the contact or the historic period as well. Because through her knowledge of gardens, for example, we were able to locate places where the French would have seasonal gardens here in the Northern Peninsula about 300 years ago. Same can be said for elders like Edmund Gould, who again had an intimate relationship with the land and just the relationship. It's very hard to describe because it was not only about knowledge, but almost, you know, this spiritual connection with the land as well in terms of its understanding. But through his knowledge, we started in 1998 with 18 sites. And then over the course of the next 20 years, based on consultation with him, we were able to increase the site number to about 36 archaeological sites in a 6-kilometer stretch of land. So it's not only adults, I guess, and the economy that would benefit from this tourism initiative and this research initiative. We also, as a community, started the Finesse program, which is a program that's designed for young women to encourage them to get into the sciences, whether it would be botany or biology or also even nature photography. So this is one of the Finesse workshops where we've hiked out to the tip of the Dog Peninsula, and we are in a picture with a cairn that Captain Cook made when he mapped this region in 1776. In addition to the sciences, we also encourage connection with culture and the arts, and of course the Newfoundland and Labrador identity as it relates to all the regions. So while scientific endeavors are important, people like Anita Best, who are folk singers and storytellers, we make sure that local youth interact with these people as well, because this is a critical part of understanding culture. This tradition bearers like Anita and this local knowledge. And of course, one of the key sort of the central tenets of what we speak to as well in our project is to always have a close relationship with the land and to respect it. So when we have these programs for youth, we talk a lot about self-reliance and, you know, making your own bed, gathering your own berries, making your own cream and butter, just having those traditional skills that can really serve us, especially where we are in these days with things like the pandemic. Being a little more self-reliant seems to certainly come in handy. Same thing can be said for hunting. In addition to gathering of the berries and the plants, in this region, many people still hunt things like moose and caribou. And we talk about this with the youth so that they can understand that this is a critical part of their culture as well. And this is a caribou shown here, obviously, not a moose. So some of the reasons, obviously, we're doing this archaeological project is not only just to understand the 5,000 years of lifeways in this province and in northern Newfoundland and the beauty of that in and of itself, but, you know, it's to have a future for people like Nathan that we see here on the left with his grandmother processing a codfish. But, you know, it's not always about the future. It's also about the present day and creating a life for the people that you share land with, so that life is lived to its fullest and its best, even in the present day, as is shown here by a typical lobster feast that we would have in these northern communities, I think, and sort of the picture of togetherness that's represented here at this particular feast. So I just want to thank you so much for listening to me today, and I hope you enjoy the stories from the rest of the storytellers in our session. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Shelton Johnson. I work as a national park ranger in Yosemite National Park, and I'm originally from Detroit, Michigan. And my passion has been to connect people of color, especially African Americans, to their national parks. I use that term specifically because African Americans, like all Americans, own their national parks. But it's like if you never received a notification of that inheritance, then you have no idea that you have some of the most beautiful landscapes in the world as part of your birthright. And that's what I've really been trying to communicate for more than 20 years, that African Americans own their national parks. This is specifically important because African Americans are the one group least likely to have a wilderness experience, least likely to seek out a wilderness experience. And that's ironic. When you communicate with them, they'll say things like, well, we don't do that. We don't visit national parks. That's not something that African Americans do. And yet 100 years ago, in 1899, 1903, and 1904, African American soldiers, known to history as the Buffalo Soldiers, were some of the first protectors of any national park anywhere in the world. Around 1900, there were only around 10 or so national parks on the planet. But today there are over 4,000 national parks in over 150 other countries. And so the power of these images of African Americans on horseback, riding in Yosemite National Park, riding in Sequoia National Park, essentially serving as wilderness rangers, conservationists, at a time when African Americans were just still reeling from the impact of slavery. This was the period of Jim Crow. This was one of the most virulently toxic, racist time periods in American history. And yet these men made that choice to decide for themselves that they were men and deserved to be treated equally and treated as such. And that's why many of them joined the military. And it's a strange thing when people think, why would an African American put on the uniform of a country that does not recognize his or her citizenship, let alone humanity? And so it was part of the civil rights movement, this action, this act to join the military and fight for a country that did not recognize your existence other than as a servant or a generation earlier as an enslaved person. So it was an act of defiance. It was an act of the civil rights movement. I always argue that the civil rights movement began the first time an African American wore the uniform of a country that did not acknowledge his own humanity. So it's much deeper than a story of African American soldiers serving as some of the first park rangers in the world. It's a story of African Americans recognizing their own humanity, asserting that humanity and reclaiming that which was African within them. If you're African, you know, you have this innate connection to the earth around you. I work in Yosemite Valley with a Maasai by the name of Olutumi, and he's from a village below the rim of the Ngorongoro crater. And he has not lost that connection to the world around him. And he's told me so many stories about the Serengeti and how that if you sleep out in the open and you're not in a tent anywhere in the Serengeti, you will be killed and eaten. And to me, that strikes me as the ultimate kind of wilderness experience when you literally may be putting yourself on the menu. That's a very dangerous environment. But at the same time, it is a liberating environment because it is an environment from which all human beings emerged, that experience of mountains, that experience of desert, that experience of being in the land, and the land is within you as well. So for me, telling the story of African Americans serving as some of the first protectors of wilderness anywhere in the world is a story of rekindling that which is African within us, that which was tried to be or attempted to be stamped from us, but is cellular, it is biological, it is spiritual, it is psychological. There's certain things that cannot be effaced, they cannot be erased, they cannot be displaced. They are all within our bones and within our marrow, that which is African. And that is why I'm so passionate about connecting African Americans to their national parks, because essentially what I'm trying to do is connect African Americans back to that which is African, back to that which is indigenous, back to that which is what it means to be a human being. It is nothing less than a rekindling of that ancestral spirit that where the earth was sacred. That is one thing that we have all lost in the industrial West. We've lost to some degree that sense of the earth as being sacred. Once you commodify a plant, once you commodify a landscape, once you commodify a mountain range, then anything can happen. Anything can be despoiled. Anything can be ruined. But once you hold that light of the sacred, that flame held high that illuminates our ancestral spirit, then you can't destroy which is that which is sacred, that which you hold dear. And that's what I'm trying to rekindle within African Americans. That immersion in the wild is an immersion back into that which was ancestral, that which is human, ultimately that which is who we are as a species. That's my work. My work is to bring back the ancestral, to bring back the indigenous within all of us so that we can no longer see the earth as a commodity, but as a temple, as a shrine, as a mosque, as a cathedral, as it once was, so shall it be in the future. And for African Americans who are the most divorced, the most separated from a wilderness experience, when they see Yosemite Valley for the first time, there is a crisis of translation, because what they've been taught, what they've been told, is that these environments are essentially it's a national park. They use that coinage, they use that term. But when they're there, all they see is the world as it once was and as it still is. What they feel is this rekindling at the cellular level of what it means to be African. And I'm saying what I'm saying, that it is possible to find Africa in America. It is possible to find that which was stripped from us on slave ships right here in California or in Montana or in Wyoming, wherever there's a national park, wherever the earth is laid bare and open for all to experience the wind, the silence. That silence and that wind is also African, even though it is here in this country, because it is the earth. And the earth is a biosphere. It's the same place. And we unfortunately are so limited in our perception that we see it as separate places, but it is the one place. And I always think about Neil Armstrong when he was on the moon and looked up, and that he could literally blot out the earth with an outstretched thumb. It was the same place. Africa, America, Europe, Asia, it's all the same place. It's all the same neighborhood. And we need to rekindle that connection between ourselves and between the planet beneath our feet if we are all to survive, let alone if we are to nourish ourselves and our children and our children's children. And that's my work. My work is to put those roots back into the earth and reconnect with that which was taken from us and that which we intentionally left behind. And I hope that we can all meet in the same place and see it for the first time. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Susan Eaton, and I'm a fellow international of the Explorers Club. Tonight, I'm delighted to be here with my fellow explorers and to share my story with all of you. And it's a story of personal revelation, a story of discovery, of exploration, and a story of reconciliation with the Indigenous peoples of the Arctic. When I started the Sedna Epic Expedition in 2013, I thought that a polar explorer was someone who conquered the planet, raced against time and nature, and achieved a first. But during the 9 years since I've been leading the Sedna Epic Expedition, which is comprised of women, I've changed my opinion of what an explorer or polar explorer actually looks like. And that's my story tonight about my journey into the snorkel zone and into the Arctic and what a 21st century explorer looks like today. My story involves exploring Northern Labrador, Baffin Island, which is part of Nunavut, Greenland, Iceland, and the Arctic regions of Norway. I'm going to take you on a journey to some of these areas and describe exactly what my team of women explorers, scientists, artists, scuba divers, cultural experts have been doing since 2014. The Arctic Ocean, as we all know, is melting at a rapid rate. The sea ice is melting, and 95% of the old sea ice, according to NOAA, 95% of the old, thick, multi-year sea ice has disappeared in the past three decades. So again, what happens in Antarctica is extremely important to the planet, as is what happens in the high Arctic. This is the story of exploration and discovery in the 21st century by a team of women who are challenging a lot of norms. What is the Sedna Epic? Well, we are exploring the planet in the snorkel zone. And the snorkel zone is the upper 5 meters of the water column. If you're a scuba diver, you try to get through the snorkel zone very quickly to deeper targets that you're interested in exploring. But if you're a snorkeler, even an underwater photographer, videographer, the snorkel zone is bathed in sunlight. And it's the place where air-breathing animals come to the surface. So it's a magical place where snorkelers interact with humans. And I've been in the snorkel zone when I could not tell the difference between the exhalations from snorkels and those of whales that were nearby. Our mission is to scout, record, and document disappearing sea ice in the Arctic. That's the Sedna Epic Expedition's mission. Before I go any further, I'd like to tell you who Sedna is. Sedna is the Inuit goddess of the sea and the mother of all marine mammals. I'd like to share a video of our expedition in 2016 to Frobisher Bay, which is located on the southeast coast of Baffin Island in the Inuit territory called Nunavut. Our team traveled to Iqaluit to work at the grassroots level with boys, girls, young women, and the community on our ocean knowledge sharing and mobilization program. We were lucky to travel across the coastline of Baffin Island in a Twin Otter aircraft here. The glaciers are hanging here. They're much diminished compared to what they used to be, but we got to see the glaciers on the south coast of Baffin Island. Our Inuit advisor there, IU Peter, was hauling in a net with Arctic char. We ran a mentorship program, ocean mentorship program for 10 young women, Inuit and Northern women, in Nunavut, teaching them how to snorkel. And for the younger children, we ran a program which consisted of aquariums and robots. And here we are filling the aquarium with salt water. The tides in Frobisher Bay are close to 45 feet, and we're getting ready to fill the aquariums while our scientific dive team is out collecting small invertebrates and fishes. Here we go, filling the touch tanks, which are great teaching tools. And the community turns out to see what the scientific divers have actually found. Since some Inuit don't swim, this is the first time they've seen some of these animals. The underwater robot camps were really, really popular with children. The robots are simple, PVC pipe, propellers, a small motor, and an underwater camera. And for children who aren't swimming, these robots bring the ocean to eye level for them. These are some of the young women in the Ocean Mentorship Program. And we're going to say goodbye here and get back to the presentation. At its essence, the Sedna Epic Expedition is a call to action. Our team includes Indigenous members and non-Indigenous members, and we are trying to combine Indigenous knowledge with conventional science, marine science, to mitigate the impacts of climate change. At its core, the Sedna Epic Expedition is about empowering women and girls across the Arctic and, in fact, across the world. We want to develop leaders who are ready to tackle the big issues facing us on the planet: climate change, ocean change, and societal change. Across the Arctic, the issues are happening in real time. The impacts of climate change are happening in real time. And the Sami women and Inuit women in our team are telling us how climate change is impacting their reindeer herds and hunting in Nunavut. Whales, seals, polar bears are all being impacted by climate change. Here we have two team members, one a Sami from Norway, who's a reindeer herder, and an Inuit team member from Nunavut. This is a photograph of our team meeting in Norway in November 2019 at the Ardna Center, which is the Sami Cultural Center at the University of Tromsø, who hosted our women's leadership program. And a Sami woman is speaking about the role that women play in the fishery in Norway. So we met for 2 days before going on to our expedition vessel, where we conducted ocean research and snorkeled during winter conditions with orcas during the winter herring run. I'd like to end my presentation by showing a short video that was recorded during a 2019 expedition to Norway. There were 14 women present on the vessel, another 5 women present during the Women's Leadership Program as well. So in total, we had about 19 women. And the Garmin video basically shows what we did in Norway, including our ocean research.
Our world is changing rapidly. Only by seeking answers can we begin to affect change. Sea ice is disappearing in the Arctic and glaciers are melting. How does this affect the migratory routes and feeding patterns of the orcas, humpbacks, and other ocean predators? 71% of the planet's surface area is covered by oceans. Climate change at the poles is warming and acidifying the sea. What should we do about it? Plastics. We know it's a threat to our oceans and food supply, but how much of a threat? How much plastic is in the water column, the plankton, buried in the seafloor? What does the future look like in 5 years or 10 years? Climate change has a human face in the Arctic, but how can we combine modern-day science with the traditional knowledge of its Indigenous people? And how can we inspire and empower them to combat ocean change and societal change? Sometimes science means packing your dive gear and your test tubes and going halfway around the world. It's going to be tough, but that's never stopped me before. I've been studying the planet for more than 30 years, and I'm humbled to lead this team. Together, we're making a real difference. I'll never stop questioning, and there's no place I won't go to find answers. I'm Susan Eaton, and I am a woman of adventure.
In closing, I'd like to introduce our new name and our new logo and our new brand to you. And this is all happening in January. And this is part of our journey, this logical change of our expedition name and focus has been changing from the time that I announced it to the Explorers Club in September 2013, that we were going to snorkel the Northwest Passage for climate change, we were going to conquer the Northwest Passage, to 9 years later, understanding that from our perspective as a group of women, we are exploring the planet differently, and we are really focused on working collaboratively with the Indigenous women in the Circumpolar Nations. We've worked in Northern Canada, Nunatsiavut, in Nunavut, we've worked in Greenland, Iceland, and now in Norway, where we will continue to focus our efforts on our ocean science work in Norway, and we'll be returning to Nunavut and Greenland in the next couple of years. But the journey has been one of reconciliation as well, and we've learned so much from our Inuit partners, our Inuit team members, and our Inuit advisors. And now we have women in the team who are Sami from Scandinavia. We have First Nations women in the team from Canada. And we're becoming much more circumpolar in our vision. And also in our appreciation and understanding of the Indigenous peoples of the Arctic. And in the spirit of reconciliation, we are retiring the name Sedna. And we've selected a new name, Sea Women Expeditions. Sea Women firmly plants us in the ocean in our teaching medium. We're showing a new logo for the first time publicly. This is a beautiful sky hopping orca with the Northern Lights behind it. It was produced by Whitley Mike, one of the team members in Sea Women Expeditions. And to us, orcas symbolize climate change as well. Orcas symbolize the changing Arctic because they're moving into the Canadian Arctic and other parts of the Arctic in larger numbers now. As sea ice disappears, so too arrive the orcas to hunt the small marine mammals that Inuit and other Indigenous people have traditionally hunted. Orcas are also matrilineal in their makeup, and the elder or the matriarch of the pod teaches and mentors the younger daughters and their offspring. So because of our all-female makeup, because we work in matriarchal communities in the North, and because we are all about promoting and advancing women in the sciences and exploration and the arts in polar exploration, we think that the orca is a great symbol as we move forward. So on that happy note, our website will be ready sometime in January, along with our new names on our social media channels. But this is where we're headed. And thank you for sharing this journey with me tonight.
This is an interesting group of people. In many cases, we bring people together under an idea and find that they none of them have ever met each other. There's no crossover whatsoever. In this case, we've got three people who are well associated with each other. And Avijan, you're calling from West Bengal. So quite a different geographic area. But all united around this idea of storytelling and the use of story in achieving conservation value, scientific value, community value. But I wanted to start with a different sense of story for a second here, which has to do with self-story, the thing you say to yourself about who you are in all of this. And I wanted to start with Susan because there's such a huge life change in your self-story. It seems to me it's an interesting, we drive ourselves to do these extraordinary things. And what is it we are telling ourselves as a story that makes us do these things? So I'm going to start with you, Susan.
Thank you so much. That's a deep question. And it's something that I probably have asked myself every decade. And you know, we change as we age and we go through multiple careers in our lives. And I think that, you know, when I turned 50, I thought, okay, is this all there is? I was working as an oil and gas executive. I really didn't love the oil industry that much. And I was thinking about what my 50s would look like. And I determined that I wanted them to be epic, I wanted them to be big, and that I wanted to invest more of my time, energy, and passion in exploring the planet and telling the stories, stories associated with climate change, ocean change, and people. And so I have spent a lot of time in the Arctic and Antarctica in the past 12, 13 years. And it's been fascinating, but it's all about story and it's all about people. And as much time as I spent in Antarctica snorkeling with leopard seals and penguins and fur seals, I was spending time in the Canadian Arctic as well. And I came to realize that the story of climate change in the north, in the circumpolar regions of the Arctic, has a human face. And so I shifted my focus from exploring Antarctica as a polar snorkeler, a geologist, a geophysicist, a journalist, and focused my efforts on the Canadian North. And in the last few years, more in a more circumpolar region, Greenland, Iceland, and Norway, working with Indigenous communities, which are matriarchal in their composition. And because of that, because the women are the leaders, my project, the Sedna Epic Expedition, is comprised of women. Women working with women, women telling stories, women collaborating and leading on many levels. And, you know, in terms of inspiring the next generation of women leaders to sit at the policy table, to be on the expedition vessels as the chief scientists, and to be present in the decision-making areas that will impact the Arctic in the next decades to come. So that's my story. And in fact, it started with a trauma in a hyperbaric chamber 15 years ago. I was a scuba diver for my entire life. And 15 years ago, I ended up in a hyperbaric chamber for 3 days. And when I emerged from the chamber, my dive career was over. But as people use the word today, I started to pivot. And I started exploring the planet in the oceans. And what I discovered was that the upper 5 meters of the oceans is where all the action is. All the air-breathing animals come to the surface. And I fell in love all over again with the ocean in that upper 5 minutes, or 5 meters, sorry. And that's where I explore today, in the snorkel zone, in the Arctic, in the Antarctic. And I've been very privileged to meet a very large group of women, both Indigenous and non-Indigenous. And we've traveled through the Arctic learning about a sense of place, time, history, culture, environment. And it's been a great odyssey. So that's my story.
So Avijan, you started out in media, perfectly good career working in media. You made a shift into this very mission-directed work. And I'm curious, again, from you, the way you tell yourself who you are to this change in your life, to your life, how does that, because it's got to be much harder to do what you do today. I'm just curious how you say to yourself, who am I? What am I doing? Why am I doing this thing?
Okay, so it started from my early career when I started after I left my school. So it was 2007. I've started my journey from there. And it's a very interesting area. When I live in a small country, a small town, which is called Siliguri. And Siliguri is a part of West Bengal state. And West Bengal is also in part of India, you know that. So the Siliguri is a small town. And from in my town, there is at least 13 to 14 kilometers are hills. So hills are not far from my home, at least 13 to 14 kilometers. So as I started my career as a birding. So I go to the forest areas, I go to the tea gardens, which is very close to my house, at least 5 to 6 kilometers from. So I used to my cycle and I have a binocular on that time. My father gave me a small binocular on that time. So I used to use my binocular to go to the field and using the birding trip to understand the bird's behavior and all those things. Then I joined my career as a, you know, media person. So in that particular time, I got so many news from the mainly the forest related areas, which is very close to my heart. So the main news which attract me, that is the elephants. So here the main turning point has came out, because I feel during the job that elephants are the most suffering animal that is living in our society right now. So we are humans. We are sharing the lots of space. Okay. So I started following the elephants, from which is very, very close, because I'm from my house, there are so many forests, okay, which is very close to my area. So there are at least 9 to 10 forest patches. But these patches are mostly the fragmented. So the story here are that elephants are mostly stay in that fragmented forest areas. So I started to go there and just to photograph them, because on that time, so I have a only basic camera. Okay, so I used to make a small camera. Okay, so just buy it from my nearest friend, and it's a second hand. So I just make a documentation to following the elephants, mainly the elephants. And after that, I go to the forest work in regular basis, just to following them. And then the story come up, because I felt that elephants are more suffering. Okay, so every single day they are suffering, the conflicts are increasing. And here in my landscape, the human population are very increasing and very fast growing. So that the main thing is that elephants are surviving here, and they are communicate with people. They are communicate with people, and peoples are also communicate with elephants. So that is the main reason. And apart from that, there are so many challenges they are facing. Not only the population, the human population is increasing, that we all know. But apart from the population, there are so many technologies, like the railway line, like the highways, and all those industries, tea gardens. Some people say that tea gardens are most friendly for the elephants. But I realize that tea gardens are now the main positive way and main the conflicted area for elephants, and also the leopards too. So here is the other things that when I used to photograph the elephants, I start to behave them. I start to study their behavior very closely. And recently, there is a small study area. So I just focus on mainly on that area, which is called the Terai portion. Terai is the western part of the Himalayas. Okay. So in Terai area, there are small patches forest. And all these forests are connected to Nepal boundary. Nepal is another country, and which is the we have a border, Indo-Nepal border. And I feel that in 2007-8, their elephants are moved towards the Nepal area. So it was their old migration route. But what they do, the people from Nepal, they try to kill the elephants, because they said that elephants are not their property. They're damaging their crops, they're damaging their houses regular basis. So they try to kill the elephants and remove their tusks. So there is a large, miscommunication with forest official of both sides, India and Nepal, has started. I came from that area, and I started to following that particular story to identify the individual elephants, which are the tusker mainly. Those had the tusks, and photographed them very closely. And after all, after 5 to 6 years study, I make a, dossier, the small dossier, which is totally the solitary bull. Totally about the solitary bulls, which are very harassed. Mm-hmm. And when I go to the, the small elephant, when I study the elephant's fact, I also learned that elephants are mostly depends on tea gardens right now. And I used to go to the tea gardens also. And there I found that there is another problem, which is more challenging than elephants. That is the leopard issue. And leopard is a rising issue, because human leopard conflict in our entire North Bengal stretch are very, very, regular wise issue. And the leopards issue are increasing day by day, because leopards are staying inside the tea garden area. And you can see the tea garden heights, which is around the 4 feet. Okay. So the leopards are easily hide inside the tea garden. So it's perfect for their body height also. So in daytime, they are staying inside the tea garden. But when the night comes, they move to the human populated area to lifting kettles and all those things. So there the story has started. What I follow that my landscape has several challenges. The most, increasing challenges is the population increase. Human population are increasing. And there is no such a, perfect route or no such a perfect passage for elephants or other wildlife. In fact, if you go to the any parts of any India right now, there is no rite of passage for elephants and other wildlife too. And this is called the corridor. So the corridors are suffering, and because of corridor suffering, elephants are also suffering, and we peoples are also suffering. But my point of view, that I am standing in between these things and try to photograph them and try to communicate with the communities, the basic level people and the ground level people also, try to educate them from myself. And I try to believe them that elephants is not harassing us. We are harassing them. So this is the main thing that I study. Thank you.
Great. Now, I'm going to go up to Latonia. You mentioned you study, the deep history, thousands and thousands of years of occupation in this land, and a sort of a story about that we don't necessarily see the way it might really be, that there are, ideas we hold about the traditional cultures of the North that really the evidence shows differently. But you yourself are within the continuum of that culture. I noticed in your bio that you mentioned that your own ancestors are part of this, northern set of cultures. And I'm curious, because it sounded like that was a discovery, how that might play into, and how does it play into or not, your story of yourself in the context of this work, but really the work we will talk about, but you, what are you to yourself in the context of this work that you are doing?
Thank you for that. Such a great question. I started as an archaeologist and worked my way into filmmaking, and those two things are quite similar. I think at the outset, people think that they're different, but I'll come back around to why I think they're the same in many ways. I grew up on the south coast of Newfoundland in a very remote area, but at the same time, it was an incredibly beautiful area. So lots of fjords, and the cultural makeup of the place also quite fascinating as well, which kickstarted my career and the journey, as you say, of understanding your place in the world and your own story. So in addition to people of European ancestry, in the area, there's also Miobugik, which is a First Nations Mi'kmaq reserve, where I have spent, so much time, pretty much half my life, I think, off and on visiting, and still have family there and have some ancestral ties to that community. And my father was also a helicopter pilot. So I was very fortunate in life that from the age of 5 to 18, I actually spent a lot of time in the air. So it felt like my life had a third dimension to it, if you know what I mean, like flying all around the south coast of Newfoundland and looking at caribou herds migrating. I mean, it's a very rich and full life. And it is sort of that fascinating part of my youth, I think, that led me to get, a PhD in Indigenous archaeology, because I was trying to understand the history of Newfoundland and Labrador. And also growing up in the place that I grew up, the sense of community and doing things for a broader community as opposed to sort of like a singular journey was something that really informed my path in life. And then once I started to dig my heels into the field of archaeology, I started to realize that the cultural makeup of Newfoundland, of course, a lot of us think about the cod fishery in Newfoundland, which is 500 years old, but really people have been living in Newfoundland and Labrador for 9,000 years. So it's a whole other trajectory of, people and culture in this place. And Newfoundland and Labrador, of course, basically, even though the island part is quite far south, the Labrador Current makes our province a very northern place. So a lot of people that lived in the Arctic actually moved eventually into Newfoundland and Labrador. And that's how I started to branch those routes out. My research station is in northern Newfoundland. And with the death of the cod fishery there, our archaeological project not only researched the last 5,000 years of the place, but those people that were displaced from the fishery also were incorporated, again, back to the sense of community, into the project as field workers, as people who were doing the research and the eventual sort of displaying of anything that we found and part of the research problem or design as well. So again, I think in terms of my story, it's always about community in a way. Like I say my story, but it's anything that I do, whether it's archaeology or films, if it doesn't involve the community and people having the ability to tell their own story or be part of the story, then for me, it probably wouldn't be worth doing as much, because I like the collective nature, you know, of everything. So the foray into film, I think, is, again, when I look at archaeology, I see it basically as, you know, the understanding the human condition, the hows, the why, you know, why people do what they do, and trying to have a portal into understanding that. And I think films are the same way, right? We make a film, whether it's a documentary or a narrative, it's all about trying to understand what human beings do. And then when I sort of made my pathway into the film industry, that sense of community and wanting to work together as a team always was reflected in that as well. So, you know, I've worked with Indigenous communities on films, and I'm currently working with the National Film Board on the Labrador Doc Project, which is training Inuit directors to direct stories about themselves, about their own culture, and, you know, training also other crew positions for Inuit people so that they have that sovereignty in their own storytelling, which is incredible. And I know that's something John will expand on, because that's where he and I overlap a lot, you know, and that's why I think we're close, because we do have similar views in that way. So I think that's basically how I came to be where I am, like, you know, in a nutshell, just growing up in a remote place, seeking to understand where it is that I came from, the culture, the people that I'm a part of. And when I step forward and make any kind of movement in the world, is how can everybody be involved? How can there be leadership and sovereignty in everybody's own story and everybody having a say? And how can it benefit everybody, especially in places like Newfoundland and Labrador in the Arctic, where, you know, there are challenges that still exist from the colonization process, and, you know, economic challenges as well, especially where I'm from. So that kind of is the long and short, I think, of how I got to the place, you know, where I am in life.
Hello, Shelton. Shelton Johnson has joined us. What we're doing right now, Shelton, I'm asking each person, since the overarching idea here is storytellers, you are a quintessential storyteller. But the question I'm asking right now has to do with the story that you tell yourself, the story that puts you out every day, what you say to yourself about who you are, that gives you the power, the force, the momentum to continue to do what it is you do. We'll talk about work and regions and all kinds of crossover stuff, but I'm interested first in this story that a storyteller tells to themselves about who they are and why they are standing and why they are speaking. So we'll see how your signal is, and see if you can address that question.
Well, the story that I tell focuses on the African-American soldiers who served in Yosemite over 100 years ago. This is a forgotten stewardship story. And initially, it may seem remote from myself, because I grew up in the inner city of Detroit, Michigan. And as a result, there were no family trips to national parks, no family trips to wilderness areas, no sense that wilderness areas belonged to me culturally, as well as spiritually, as well as with regard to my family. And part of it is that this connection actually was forged in my early childhood. I'm the son of a military veteran. I lived in Germany and England. And there were trips to Berchtesgaden before it became a national park in the Bavarian Alps. And there was a trip to the Black Forest when I was a child. I was only 5 years old. And I consider that to be my baptism, if you will. That was my introduction to the wild. And the reason why that was so important was that I was born in Henry Ford Hospital in Detroit, Michigan. I grew up in a very African-American culture. Detroit has the highest percentage of African Americans of any major city in the United States. And let's just say that there were no family trips to national parks growing up in Detroit. No one in my schools, none of my teachers, none of the educators spoke about national parks. The national park idea itself was an idea that was remote, both culturally, figuratively, and experientially. And so there was no way that someone like myself growing up where I grew up would ever feel this sense of kinship. this sense of homecoming in a national park had it not been for this earlier experience in Germany, where I was in the Black Forest, where I was in the mountains, and I should say where the mountains were in me and the forest was growing within me. And holding onto that seed is what kept my sanity, what kept me connected to the earth itself. And I realized that that story, that natural story, that wilderness story, the story of mountains rising, is the story of my spirit rising and finding this connection with the outside world. And I have to say, that is not an easy thing. When you are African American, growing up in an urban area anywhere in the United States in the last 50 years or so, keep in mind that the communication of the national park story in the United States was not specifically inflected toward people of color. I'll say that again. The whole notion of a national park idea was never historically inflected to communicate to people of color. So even though it's perceived as America's best idea for a fair percentage of the population, we never heard that idea, that we never got or received that invitation. We were never made to feel that this idea, this story, was our story. But because it was personally in my own blood, in my own ancestry, my own personal experience, I connected to mountains. I connected to wildness. And I held onto it in the way that soil holds onto a seed, and that seed sprouts in that soil that became my own spirit. And I felt this connection that none of my classmates growing up in Detroit felt. And it was an experience that they've never had. So when I, at some point, ventured into the wilderness, meaning I accepted a job working in Yellowstone National Park when I was in graduate school. I was in graduate school majoring in poetry. My background is classical music and poetry and literature, completely separate from the notion of being a wilderness manager or being a national park ranger. But it actually fit because that was who I was. And I found that who I was the world that I was that was around me, meaning I awakened, if you will, and when I was in Montana, when I was in Yellowstone. And so my work has basically been trying to connect the disconnected, trying to make these cultures that never received the invitation. I mean, it's basically that situation of when you're a child or growing up, everyone wants to get invited to the party. Well, the National Park story is a great story. It's a great party. It's a great celebration of the earth itself. But if you've never received that invitation, you don't feel that you're welcome in that environment. And because of the history of Jim Crow, because of the history of separate and unequal, Plessy versus Ferguson, we don't necessarily feel comfortable going into these outdoor spaces. So in a nutshell, my role has been, that my self-appointed role has been to connect these disconnected populations, the Latinx populations, African Americans, Asian Americans, those who do not feel that the national park story has a narrative thread that involves their own ancestry, and to make them feel that this is an inheritance that belongs to everyone, every human being. And that's why the national park story is so important to me. It's not so much national parks, it's about connecting to the earth itself. And I've always felt that all the problems that we have in the world today as a result of industrialization are rooted literally in the Industrial Revolution. That's the beginning of the disconnect. That is the beginning of the psychic, spiritual, psychological disconnect from the sacred and the commodification of nature. When we see nature as a commodity, when we see nature and speak of it as a resource, and our language itself does not reflect anything sacred, any kind of anything that is a sacrament, then that results in the commodification, that results in the destruction, that results into where we are right now. So the loss of the sacred is tied to, in the West, the Industrial Revolution, which I believe is the beginning of that disruption and that corruption of our relationship with the world itself. And for me, national parks are that doorway back to the beginning, back to the ancestral beginning, because we always forget every human being on this earth descends from indigenous people. We all were indigenous. We all are indigenous from somewhere. And if you're listening, if you're talking to an evolutionary biologist, they'll say it's Africa. We're all African underneath the sin. There's greater diversity in terms of the genetics of Africans from other Africans than any African from anyone else in the world. It's where we all come from. But at the same time, some of us have lost that connection because it is not just that it was lost, it was taken away. So I'm really in the business of restoring that connection between African Americans to the earth itself. And I feel that that is where we all need to go. If we see the sacred and feel that sacrament when we look at the world around us, then the despoliation, the ruin of the planet will stop. And I think it stops because we no longer see it as a resource. And that's why I think language is so powerful in this. But in a nutshell, that's what I'm trying to do. That's what I've been doing. And that's what I will do until I no longer can draw a breath.
That is perfect to lead me over to John Houston, who grew up in two languages. And as you say, language is a window into perception. Language is a window into seeing the world. Language can change literally what we think we're even seeing. And John, you grew up in two. I'd love to hear your answer to this same question. What is the story you tell yourself about how you became, not biographically, but you know, the essence of what it is that you say to yourself that makes you be the person who does what you do?
Thank you for that penetrating question. And I'll try to do it justice. I started off, as you say, growing up between two cultures on the southwestern tip of Baffin Island up in Canada's Arctic. And my parents, the late James and Alma Houston, were there working with the Inuit, partnering with the Inuit to develop their arts, something that ended up being known all around the world as Inuit art. And we're very, very proud of that. But for my own story as a kid, a couple of things happened when I was four, as I recall it. One was I started making art. I was making my own little prints and stuff in the print shop there, and I still have some of those. And so the idea forming of being somehow interacting with the world as an artist. And then the other thing that happened at that time is that I was pressed into service as an interpreter. There were very few individuals in our little community of kind of 200 people when we were getting going, and very few of us could actually speak both languages, and so Inuktitut and English. And so I would be hauled out of wherever I was, it was started in school, they'd just come over and they'd sort of stand in the doorway until somebody looked up and they'd, you know, come on. And I'd have to come out and I'd go and maybe up to the nursing station, because the Inuit were coming in out of the camps and they'd have ailments, and the male nurse didn't speak a word of the language, and he would have to try to understand what was going on. I hope I didn't do too much damage. I tried to do good, not harm there. But in any case, that was the start of being a bridge of some sort. And, there would be journalists who would come to town from some of the known magazines, Look and Life and Time and the German magazine, Er und Sie, I recall, and so on. And if nobody else was available, I would be again pressed into service. And what I came to realize at a very young age is that there were barriers, and not simply the barrier of language. It would not be enough to transliterate, to just take the words that one person was saying and kind of transpose them over into the other language. There would still be a lack of understanding. And so that's where I started to understand the difference between translating and interpreting. And I started to see that until the light went on, until the light bulb went on, you hadn't done your job. And so, you know, the hardest test is humor. If someone tells a joke, you know, in one language, and then, you know, until the people listening start laughing, you haven't done your job. They don't get it. You haven't done it. And so somewhere along the line, there was this idea, living in a small community, a very close community, the idea, as Latonia mentioned as well, the idea of being part of a community and trying to help the community. The idea of trying to sort of bridge a gap and to try to help with a kind of translation of ideas to bridge these gaps of not only of language, but also of culture and of distance. There's tremendous gaps there, and to try to help to bridge those. And so that became one idea, one sense of purpose. But then at the same time, there was this thing of having started off making art and loving doing that and sort of interacting with the world in a way through the frame of being an artist. And I guess in a way your question's forcing me to look at this more deeply. I guess my life since then, it's been a fair bit of time, trying to sort that out. There's been a kind of a tension between the two, that on the one hand, I'm strongly drawn to help the community, to help facilitate, to help bridge the gap. And then on the other hand, as an artist, wanting to try to, express ideas that I might have. And so through the filmmaking, there was a clue. When I was 6 years old, Inuit wanted a recreation center, some place to have dances on a Friday night and maybe watch some films and whatever you do in a community center. And they went to my dad, and he was the sort of local government guy as well as facilitating the arts and so on. And he said, well, there's no budget, for anything like that right now. But what there is there's a lot of kind of government stuff, like people, there's wood here, and there's he knew where everything was. And he said, there's a lot of stuff around. He said, would you people build it? And there were a lot of kind of rough carpenters and so on there among the Inuit. And they said, we'll build it. We were very highly motivated. And my dad said, well, I'll design it. So he drew out some plans, and Inuit, put the thing together, and at no real project cost other than scrounged materials and volunteered labor, suddenly, poof, we had a community hall, a recreation center. And we used to go there and watch films. And those films would have been, as I realize today, they would have been in their first run. This was back in the mid 50s. And we got the old Westerns and so on. We got High Noon, The 310 to Yuma, I remember that, and so on. And these were, Hollywood Westerns. And I imagine it like this. I imagine that they made their circuits, like all around the world. They went everywhere and they played, exhausted themselves in the mountains in the Philippines or wherever it all was, until in the end, these big, what were they, hexagonal or octagonal, big film canisters made their way back to Hollywood. And they said, okay, that's it, we're done. And then somebody said, wait a second, I'm just imagining this. Someone said, what about those poor bastards, up on Baffin Island? They've never seen anything. Oh, yeah, okay. So we were like the end of the end of the end of the first run of these things. And luckily for me, because I got to see some brilliant, brilliant films, kind of a generation later, but in their first run, weirdly, it was like some wrinkle in time. And so anyway, we're sitting there, a 16mm projector, one projector. So, every time between the reel changes, there'd be three reels. Between the reel changes, we just all have to kind of sit there and entertain ourselves. And they put it on and screen it against a bed sheet, initially. And so anyway, I had a quirk even back at the age of six, which was everybody'd be watching the screen. I watched the people watching the screen. I still do that. So anyway, this made a very powerful impression on me, which was I thought of drinking, because these people were there and lit by the light from the screen, there they were, and their eyes were wide open, and they were sort of like drinking or breathing almost. It to my youthful gaze, it looked like they were drinking the information in from the screen. They were just like absorbing it. They were all about it. And I remember thinking, that is it. That is the thing. Like, in terms of bridging a gap, there's no greater tool. I still today think there's no greater tool to bridge that gap than film. So the possibility that one could be, on the one hand, an artist, that you could create and you could share your own kind of impressions or your own ideas, but at the same time that you could kind of bridge a gap and help your community, that the two could be one. That was sort of the ideal, I guess, when I was about six. That was kind of the golden ideal. And today, in some measure, like to the degree that I can stick to that, I'm a happy person, because it seems like those are two sides of the same coin on my best days. On my worst days, I just feel like, wow, I'm struggling so hard to try to make something work that maybe it's impossible. But right now it feels good. I've just come back from the Republic of Korea, where they showed my film, Atautikut, Leaving None Behind. So the voices of the Inuit and Cree of of Northern Quebec got to be heard all around the world. And at the same time, I was recognized as the artist who had created it. So it just seemed like happiness for everybody. And I felt like one happy person instead of two struggling people.
All of you in one way or another have talked about working inside community. All of you have one way or another reflected upon the stresses that are impacting these communities. I'm curious about enlistment, how you work to get people on your side, or maybe that's not really quite the right way, how you work to get people to coalesce around what must be done. I'm going to start again with you, Avijan, just because it's so dire where you are. The situation is so extreme between people who really are struggling to feed themselves and elephants who are struggling to feed themselves. This is an absolute and ultimate need. And what you say to people, what you do to enlist people to participate in this action so that there is some way of harmony, there is some road towards harmony. How do you enlist people?
Okay, the thing that I seen the most, which is much needed in this field, in this situation, that is the education. And I strongly believe that education is the only key. If I able to understand them, if I able to educate the ground level people about the positive way about elephants and other wildlife or environments, like we have so many communities here. Okay, there are at least 19 and 20 communities in this landscape, and they are not educated people. Most of them are not educated people. So when I go to the field, I have to communicate with them. I have to deal with them. But I realize that there are lack of education. There are much more superstitions right now. They believe that elephant is the god. Like an example, they believe that elephant is the god. So I have a point here that elephant is the god by their point. So I just need to use that point that elephant is the god. So why are you blaming elephants? Because in that means that you are blaming your god. Right. So that is the thing I realized. So the basic level education, like to understand the environment, that trees is needed, the forest is needed, the fresh water is also needed. So it is our own property. So we have to conserve this. I have seen so many NGOs, I have seen so many groups, they are working here, but most of them are going to the banners to highlight their banner, to highlight their name. But none of them are go for the education, the right way of education. So I started a small initiative, which is called the Hathi Path. In Bengali, we called it Hathi Path, but if you translate in English, that means the elephant education. That means their learning started with elephants and ended up in a environmental facts. So I used to, I try to make this the Hathi Path program, the Hathi Path awareness camp, the elephant education awareness camp, by through the the young ages people, through the children's, through the very young ages children's. So I have a good response from them. So every Sunday, because in India Sunday is the holiday, and every Sunday I try to communicate with those children in a particular villages. And make a 5 to 7 classes in each month, so 4 to 5 classes in each month. And then I try to make a deal with this children. So how to communicate with elephants, how to communicate with your surrounded nature and environments also. And that is the main thing that I strongly realized, because those children, when they grow up, they learn how to deal with my surrounded nature and all those things. proper way of conservation. I know in my area, because my area has so many challenges, I already told you. And in mostly tea garden areas and the village areas, we have so many uneducated people. So I try to make a responsibility to educate them. That is the thing.
So I'm going to go to Shelton next, because the challenge of enlistment for you has to do, it's inherent in the problem. Where are the people to be spoken to that you are trying to engage? The community of African Americans who are disengaged from the story of the national park. How do you reach out and enlist the people you are trying to speak to, and what do you use as a tool to pull them in?
I have unmuted myself, which is to a great degree thematically what I've been doing. I have unmuted the past. I have unmuted history. Yosemite was once protected. Yosemite is the third oldest national park in the United States. It was once protected by African-American soldiers, known to history as the Buffalo Soldiers, in 1899, 1903, and 1904. And these soldiers built the first trail to the top of Mount Whitney, the highest mountain in the contiguous United States. They built the first usable wagon road into Sequoia's giant forest, which of course are the largest trees on earth. And they built what's considered to be the first museum in the national park system, an arboretum near the South Fork of the Merced River in the southern part of Yosemite National Park. They did all of that, but because of the racial attitudes that existed in the United States at that time, those contributions have been lost. And more importantly, that story of contribution was lost. So essentially my work has been communicating that story, amplifying that story, so that that my own people would hear that story and feel this connection, because their perception is that national parks have nothing to do with them. So when they hear that people who look like them were some of the first park rangers anywhere in the world, that is an incredibly powerful connection. And what I'm doing in this is something much greater. What I'm trying to do is connect formerly indigenous people, African people from the west coast of Africa. Those are their ancestors. I'm trying to connect them through story, through history, to their own experience of being in the wild, from it being a negative, as it is perceived today, to a positive experience. And that's part of the challenge. When people have been disenfranchised, disconnected, removed from that experience of the wild, and then they have culturally adjusted to that removal, then they're not inclined to go out into the wild because of our legacy in the United States of slavery and racism, particularly the period of Jim Crow. And that's what many African Americans remember. They remember the Ku Klux Klan. They remember the Knight Riders. They remember lynchings in the woods, but they don't remember this familial, psychologically bound connection, spiritual connection to the earth, which is the ancestral connection back in Africa. And so what I'm doing is essentially telling all of those stories, weaving them all together, but putting the roots that were severed back into the earth again. I am the only permanent African-American park ranger in the Sierra Nevada. There are no permanent park rangers that are African-American in Sequoia National Park, which is the second oldest national park in the United States. And I'm the only permanent African-American park ranger in Yosemite. And yet 100 years ago, hundreds of African-Americans were the sole protectors of both Yosemite National Park and Sequoia National Park. So it's that story, that legacy that I'm communicating, so that African-Americans, when they have that thought that these places do not belong to us, they realize not only do they belong to us, we were there at the beginning. We were protecting these places at the beginning. Yosemite is a World Heritage Site, UNESCO World Heritage Site. African Americans can lay claim to that connection, to that history, to that stewardship story, if they know that story. But now you'll meet so many African Americans who will say things like, we don't go to the mountains, the KKK, the Ku Klux Klan is there, we don't go into nature, because we have these connections that are negative, these associations that are tied to Jim Crow, that period of racism that exists in the United States subsequent to the Emancipation Proclamation. And that's kind of what we remember. We think of wilderness spaces as places that are not only comfortable for us, but are dangerous for us. So the irony of all of this, that which we culturally perceive as dangerous leads to spiritual renewal, spiritual connection, to ancestral connection. As I said, I am African, Cherokee, Choctaw, and Seminole, as well as being African-American. And I like to tie all that together, but I also want to connect people back to place. And every human being, if you go back far enough, was indigenous somewhere. And if you go back farther still, we're all African underneath the skin. So it's speaking in these universal terms and telling these universal stories and tying it to the specificity of Yosemite and Sequoia and California. Those are the tools that I'm using to reconnect the disconnected.
Susan, on this theme of disenfranchisement, sense of boundary, things you're not supposed to cross, and the whole theme of women, and in particular, like a double boundary of women and indigenous women and the ocean and the boats and the crews and the whole thing that you've talked about in some of what I've read, and how you enlist people, because think about that. That's another boundary you know is there. It's a boundary people are aware of. It's not a mystery. How you enlist people in crossing this boundary and joining you and partaking in this world.
Yes, there's so many parallels here in this conversation, and inserting the word gender into the discussion is what I've been working on, in fact, my entire life. As I started out by saying, I've worked in fairly male-dominated fields in earth sciences. I was actually in the armed forces as well, in the infantry. And that feminine voice in me was suppressed in order to survive in some of these environments. And in the past 15 years, I've been focused on amplifying my feminine voice and trying to solve some of the world's problems by closing that gender gap, by including women at the decision-making table, by inspiring and leading teams of women and mentoring women, so that the future of, if we talk about the Arctic or the planet in general, women are involved in the conversations and their stories are being told. Because we know that in the history books, there's not many stories of women leading, in whether it's leading in wartime or leading in corporations or leading in society. So the women's stories have been largely absent in the exploration community, at the Explorers Club, which is just celebrating 40 years of women in the club. The stories have been missing in the science community and at the political level. So I think with my work in the Arctic, working, which involves women, only women and girls, we're trying to integrate these voices on a platform that is safe for women to participate in, potentially to fail within, and to give these young women, mid-career women, indigenous and non-indigenous, an opportunity to gain the experience in the field, both working in indigenous communities. We're currently working with Sami in Scandinavia, Inuit in Canada, and we have First Nations women in our team now from Canada. Americans would describe them as Native Americans. In Canada, we say First Nations. We're becoming much more circumpolar in our outlook, and women are at the table discussing issues and the intersection of climate change in the Arctic, sovereignty, human rights, food security, and gender. It's all coming to the fore, and women need to be part of that discussion in order to move the dial forward. Women, I think, explore the planet differently than men do. They seem to try to understand a sense of place. For female explorers, I don't think it's about the first to the top of the mountain or the first to the bottom of the ocean. I think it's about understanding a place through its people, the eyes of its people, and collaboration. It's about traveling with purpose, exploring with purpose, and collaborating and taking our lead from the indigenous people who we work with, taking our lead from the people whose communities we're invited into to speak with, to participate with. We run education and outreach programs as well that are ocean-based. And in the traditional sense in the South, we might call it education outreach. But in the North, we've rephrased that. We call it ocean knowledge sharing and mobilization. It's a two-way sharing, Inuit traditional knowledge side by side with scientific data collection, which would be much more conventional Western science. We aim to create a space where all women, Indigenous and non-Indigenous, have a voice, they're respected, they are celebrated and are mentored so that as we move forward and there's tough decisions to be made with respect to the planet, including the Arctic regions, women are at the table and they're leading. So I think that we've heard about language here today, and language can exclude people. So we're trying to reframe the language of what an explorer looks like, of what leaders look like, and put women at the forefront. So that's what we've been working on. I've been working on that, and it's been really exciting to see all the connections that we're making. And our team, one other point too, our team ranges in age from 16 to 78. And so another part of this is ageism, and there's discrimination based on ageism. And with the women's team that I lead, we want women in their 70s and we want women in their teens, because we believe that women of every decade have something very significant to say, to impart, and to contribute to the discussion of conservation, of sovereignty in the Arctic, and so on. So we are looking at a very multi-age group, people from all nations, backgrounds, indigenous people, non-indigenous women. And so it's really, I think, representing what the world looks like, because we need our elders, we need the voices of our youth, and together I think we're more strong. We're more powerful.
I'm curious if you could describe, I used to say a typical day, but a typical day could be sitting in an office filling out like grant requests. So not a typical day, but a great quintessential day, a day that describes what it's like to do what you do, but is a really good day. And I'm going to go to Latonia first.
I think I've chosen, you know, well in my life, and just waking up every day, I'm so enthusiastic always about what I do. So even if it's desk work, I still find it very much engaging. But I think being outside and out on the land specifically, because growing up in a rural place like I did, land-based knowledge and interacting with it is something that is a critical part of my life. So I think for me, it definitely always has to be something that's outside if it was to be sort of this best day. And the other thing that would bring another level to it is if I would be collaborating with my colleagues, if it's something that both involved archaeology and film, especially working with Indigenous people again, you know, problem solving, you know, together, or also interpreting, which, you know, I'm very inspired by some of the things that Shelton is saying as well. So if my knowledge especially could intertwine with an Indigenous person's knowledge as well, to somehow interpret and create a story of the landscape that I am on, and helps educate other people and brings them into that world, especially in the north, of the beauty and the antiquity of that story, I think for me, that would just be the best.
I'm going to go to Avijan. Just a day, a really, really good day. What happens on a really good day?
Actually, I'm very enthusiastic in my field work days. So I started every single day with, when I'm available in my home. So I've started my day and I wake up in early morning, and I go to every single day to field, every single day, not only weekdays or all this, but I'm using my every single day and go to the field, whatever I see, the communicate with people or to communicate with wildlife and to understand their behavior. So and try to photograph them. Well, one of my best hobbies is to photograph, and I learned so many things during the photographs and try to understand them. And that is probably the best time in every single day when I go to use my camera and go to the field, but I didn't find any wildlife, but I must learn without the photographs. So that is the most important thing, that all 30 days in a month. So I didn't get any particular shots, but I'm still learning from the people, the ground people. And that brings me to focus to how to communicate with those people, which helps you to make this conservation possible.
John, a great day. That is also a quintessential day.
I'm in the Inuit community, Central Arctic community of Taluktuaq, and filming my fourth film, Kivio, which is the story of an ancient Inuit shaman who is perhaps one of the first people on Earth and is reputed, is thought among elders to still be alive today. So he would be one of the certainly maybe the oldest person on Earth. So I'm trying to seek out the people who know his story and so forth. And he had two great marriages in his life. He married the goose woman, and he married fox woman. And I felt like I kind of understood goose woman just from my own life in some ways, but fox woman sort of eluded me, and I really wanted to try to tell her story properly. And we had elders teaching youth how to perform the whole thing as a kind of like an Inuit theater piece. And then we filmed that. It was quite convoluted in that way, with the elders being the knowledge holders. And this was a research trip to 2004, a research trip before all that filming. So we did everything on videotape. And there we were gathering this information. I hardly sleep on these field trips. It's a combination of we work so long, and then I'm so excited at the end of the day with all the stuff we gather is just bubbling and bubbling in there. I think I see Joe nodding, you know, just what I'm talking about, and the rest of you as well, I'm sure. And you know, there it all is, and I'm sort of working away on that. So sleep is hardly an option. And then eventually I fall into some kind of a fitful sleep. And this night, it just really went to bed really thinking, like, how can I get this whole story of Fox Woman right? You know, I go to sleep, and then in my dream, I sort of see myself dreaming. I see myself lying there sleeping and sleeping fitfully and kind of dreaming. And here comes Fox Woman, and she's beautiful. She's the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. A very elegant, very fastidious, her clothing all just perfectly sewn by herself, because she wouldn't trust anyone else to do it, sort of thing. And she comes over and she just kind of lights on the edge of my bed, just and ready to vanish like a puff of smoke. Like if I make any threatening gesture or move or anything like that, she's just ready to go, but she just kind of perches there. And while she's perched there, she starts to inform me, like in my dream. She says, no. She says, your whole approach to the story, it's not right. It's got some real problems, you know, and so you're going to have to listen carefully. And I'm going to tell you some things. And she starts telling me, she starts informing me, describing the ins and outs, the intricacies of her story. And I don't know what language that was in. I mean, I guess the options would be Inuktitut or English or Fox language. No idea. But anyway, it was there it all was. And I woke up late, you know, for we get an early start in the morning, but I kind of woke late with this all still kind of in my mind. And I was fuzzy, I was groggy, almost no sleep. And I stumbled out into the common area, the kind of breakfast area. And there's my crew, who are half Inuit and half, Nova Scotian, basically, there they are. But there's also a storyteller there, Kira Van Dusen, who's Russian originally, and it lives in Vancouver. I wanted a storyteller on the team. And there they all are sitting there. They're kind of finishing breakfast. And I walk out and I look at them kind of with a groggy, fuzzy kind of a look. And I still have one foot in the mythic, and I'm trying to get my other foot planted in the world of reality. And the first word I hear is foxes. And I say, what? And they said, foxes, Arctic foxes. I said, why are you saying that to me right now? Why are you talking about foxes? They said, there are foxes. There are foxes all everywhere. I said, somebody's going to have to like take me by the hand and help me to understand what's going on, because I didn't know what universe I was in, you know. So they took me, Kira Van Dusen, the storyteller, led me outside. I got to put some slippers on at the last moment, led me outside. All around the community were these Arctic foxes, around the hotel, everywhere. And I stood there, and she stood there, and there was an Arctic fox between the two of us, like right there, you know? And so then I went back in just completely bemused. You know, I didn't know what world I was in. And I went back in and I said to one of the hotel staff, I said, I guess, you know, at this time of year, what happens? The foxes all come in and surround the community. They said, oh no, this never happens. That was a good day for me.
Susan, I'm going to ask you about a quintessential day that is great, that helps me understand what a day is like and helps me understand why is that so great.
In 2016, during the summer, our team spent several weeks in Iqaluit, which is on the southeast coast of Baffin Island in Nunavut. And our ocean knowledge sharing and mobilization program is a big part of what we do. The program's offered to youth of all ages, boys and girls. And so a typical day, an amazing day on the breakwater in Iqaluit was two large saltwater aquariums filled with sea critters that our scientific divers collected. We temporarily housed the sea critters in the aquariums and then would release them later back into the ocean. But it's a great learning opportunity for a lot of youth who may not swim or certainly aren't swimming in the cold waters to see the animals that live beneath the waves. And we would ask them and their parents and grandparents what the Inuktitut names were for these animals. And a lot of people didn't know. Some did, usually the older people. And were there any Inuit legends that were attached to these animals? Because it was all part of the knowledge sharing back and forth. I've got the scientists who can tell them how starfishes work, but we don't know the Inuktitut name for starfish, nor do we know the legends. Very, very exciting to see the entire community come out and hundreds of children lining up to stick their hands in the aquariums and pull the animals out to have a learning moment. So the second part of our program is underwater robot workshops. Kids build them and the robots have cameras on them. So when they fly them underwater, they can see what lies beneath the waves that way. And again, the kids don't need any instructions. They're better at it than the adults are. And if they design it and they fly it and it doesn't work, they come back, they pull it apart, PVC pipes, battery, sort of operated motors and propellers. We started out with eight robots that afternoon, and we ended up with probably only four complete robots at the end of the day because we're missing propellers, we're missing motors, cameras, and so on. And we thought, what are we going to do the next day? We only have four, and there's hundreds of children here. And so we came to the pier the next morning, setting up shop. And the most exciting part of my day was the next day, that day, because three young Inuit girls were waiting for us at the pier because they wanted to build robots again a second day. The tides are about 15 meters, close to 45 feet in Frobisher Bay. And at low tide, these girls went out and picked up all the pieces that had been knocked off the robots, the propellers, the cameras, the battery packs, and so on. They picked them up, they collected them, and they brought them to us that morning so that we could build robots again. So that's a very exciting moment for me because the kids were, you know, engaged. These were three young women who wanted to build robots a second day in a row, and they made it happen. So that to me was very exciting.
Shelton, you're very, very eloquent. I'm going to give you the last in this sequence of a quintessentially great day, a day that helps me understand what every day is like, but is a great day.
Any day in Yosemite is a great day, but a particularly great day would be for me to welcome a group of young inner city kids of color who are African-American, Asian-American, even Native American, Latinx, who have never been to a national park before, who have never been to Yosemite Valley before, and to tell them that they own Yosemite Valley, to tell them that this is their birthright, to tell them that this is their inheritance, to tell them that they have arrived home and everything around them is something that is a part of who they are as a human being, not just as an American. This is everyone's birthright. The earth itself is everyone's birthright. And when you can tell young people who perhaps do not come from privilege that Yosemite National Park, the Grand Canyon, Zion, Canyonlands, Arches, Wrangell St. Elias, that all of these celebrated landscapes are part of their birthright and part of their inheritance. To tell a young person who comes from struggle, who comes from challenge, who comes from difficulty, who does not come from a sense of economic privilege, to tell them that they own places that are priceless and beyond value is an incredibly powerful experience, not just for the teller, not just for the students to hear that, but for me to tell that story. That is a great privilege, and that's a great day, because you can just see it in their eyes when they're looking at Yosemite Falls. And one young man said to me, he held back from the group because he had never seen anything like Yosemite Falls in the springtime. This is a waterfall that that when it's flowing in the springtime at night during a full moon, you can see a lunar rainbow. You can see a rainbow in the middle of the night at 11 o'clock at midnight in Yosemite Falls. And he's looking at it. And he separated himself from the group because he was so enthralled by what he was saying. And I went back and I said, "Are you okay? Is everything all right?" And he didn't even look at me. All he said was, I just had no idea that such beauty existed. And that has always stayed with me. So that I want every kid in America, every kid in the world that lives in an urban setting, to rekindle that connection to the earth. And when you're witnessing it, when it's happening in front of you, it is a spiritual, religious experience to see the joy in these children's faces who are urban, to see something in front of them that they had not expected, but it was profound, it was moving, and it was transcendent. That is a great day for me as a ranger in Yosemite.
Obviously, we, the Explorers Club, were embarked on a kind of a project here of trying to expand our own definition of exploration, expand the voices that speak about exploration, and through that, to be able to explore the meaning of the Explorers Club itself, to make what was familiar become unfamiliar itself and worthy of exploration by adding voices, by adding points of view, by adding persons, parts of the world, walks of life. And so I'm curious, in light of that, to ask each of you what your hopes are for what this enterprise might be able to do. What is your hope for the future of the Explorers Club and of your work as it relates to the Explorers Club, the best that this might become? And I will start with you, John Houston.
Well, again, another great question, and thank you for it. If it's okay, I don't know how this will edit out, but if it's okay, I would just like to go back. In order to go forward, I would like to go back to something beautiful that Shelton just said, which was, he said, he quoted this fellow who had set himself apart as saying, "I just had no idea that such beauty existed." That's a powerful, powerful statement. And he characterized it as a kind of a spiritual or religious experience. And it relates directly back to in Inuktitut, the language one of the two languages I grew up with, is relates to something called tapalto or tapalno. And the opposite of it would be, Joe, if I was like messing with you, you know, if I got in your face and I, you know, picked your glasses off and looked at them and said, "Well, do they have these in an adult size, Joe?" You know, or something, and put them, you know, I was teasing you, getting in your face, bugging you. That would be tapasukto, okay? Tapalto, to explain it, it's the opposite of that. It's like hands off, or it's like hats off, or something like that. It's like you might have thought this was someone you could kind of mess with, but then all of a sudden it's like your eyes open, you see a greater reality, and you realize, whoa, can't touch this. This is great. This is something great. So I guess that's what I would say, is that if it's possible for, as Joe, as you said, you know, this idea of making that was familiar unfamiliar, and the idea of shaking this whole thing up and taking away the preconceptions, taking away the colonialist overlay, taking away the suppression of voice, the suppression of women, the suppression of elders, the suppression of indigenous people, the suppression of people of color, all of that stuff that at one point was sort of taken for granted as part of a societal fabric, okay? It was wrong, but it was taken for granted. And if it was possible through this what we're doing, to shake that stuff all up and get rid of the preconceived notions, get rid of the old society of privilege and underprivilege and all that sort of stuff, so that all of a sudden some of these things, that some of these people, some of these stories that have been suppressed and have been disregarded, can all of a sudden be seen for what they are, and all of a sudden people can be like, which is like, wow, holy smokes. Like, I had no idea that such glory, such majesty existed in this unexpected place.
Latonia?
Yeah, I definitely echo what John is saying, of course, because our work overlaps such a great deal. and I think in terms of moving forward, I think about making a space for everyone. And I feel like that's a very common theme among what everybody is saying here. Diversification, the term itself, exploration, I feel needs to evolve. For such a very long time, it's always kind of been pitched as like the purview of men, and also as like something where you conquer a land or discover a land or something like that. But it's much more rich and complex. And I think that if you have more people with a seat at the table, the word in and of itself organically may evolve, because people have different conceptions or ideas about what it actually is and what it actually means. I mean, some people may think it's simply just to push your own self beyond the points of which you're comfortable. You know, there's a very physical aspect to exploration, but there's also a very conceptual part of it, I think, as well, where, you know, you're reaching things being in your mind, you know, pushing yourself to do things that involve a number of people, the broader community as a whole, as opposed to like a single endeavor for one person. So for me personally, that's what I really would love to see as the future of, you know, the word exploration itself, and also the Explorers Club. And I think also, if that's the approach, you just really have more people being active in telling their own stories, which for me also is incredibly important.
Avijan, what is your hope for the future of this project we are embarked
on? So here is the thing that I'm most likely to say, that all of them have said, yeah, we need to engage more people. We need to engage more people, and we obviously, and we must to engage in a very sensitive areas which are not explored yet. And I believe that in my landscape, not only in particular small landscape, but if you go to the entire Himalayan region or the Western Ghat of the India, there are very few places are discovered. Most of the places are totally uncovered and unexplored, but we need more people to follow this, and we need more people to engage in this matter and to make a different kinds of story. So suppose I obviously relate the conflict related stories, but I don't like to, you know, cover the conflict related stories, because that is the negativity side. That is the negative side to impact the people more. But I want to make some, you know, the positive way to understand people, what is the main conservation is with the positive way. So I believe that if we engage the small, you know, the grassroots peoples in our explorers platform, so we can manage a better way to make it a large way, and to, we will definitely share a huge message to all the people. So I think that.
And Susan?
I was delighted to see the first 50 selected by the Explorers Club because of the diversity, because almost 50% of them were women. There were people of color. There were indigenous people. There were activists. There were storytellers. It was extremely diverse. And for me, that's what exploration is about. And we're all role models for not only children who can see themselves as explorers in all of us, but we're role models for society as well, I believe, in terms of showing them what's possible. We all come up with ideas, and all of us have ideas, and we translate them into programs and we tell stories. So I think that I'm very encouraged that we're moving in the right direction at the Explorers Club, and that young people will be coming through and seeing their role models, seeing themselves in these roles. And that's really important to me is the future is youth. I think that everyone needs to have agency, feel that they belong. And so I hope that this initiative, this big experiment, and I don't think it's an experiment, it's actually moving with the times for the Explorers Club, is going to be much more inclusive. And as we move forward, I think that humanity will reap the benefits of more people being included, of more voices at the table, and of more stories coming to the fore. Because I think that that's the solution for the problems that face us on the planet, is everyone speaking their truth. Thanks so much.
Shelton?
I just want to say it's a privilege to be part of this group, and I've enjoyed listening to everyone tell their story. And since storytelling is part and parcel of what I do, I think it's important for all of us to recognize that we are all the legacy of the Earth itself telling a story. The Earth has been telling a story for 4.5 or so billion years, about 4.5 billion years or so. And we are all part of that narrative. There is this greater narrative that is being communicated through genetics. There's a greater narrative that's being communicated through diversity. And diversity of life form, species variation, and these are all stories the Earth itself is telling. And so everything around us, every living thing around us is kindred. Every living thing around us is family. And so when we look at a rhinoceros, when we look at an elephant, we look at a dolphin, it's still part of our story. And so that sense of separation that we have, that we've been taught, needs to be replaced with integration, needs to be replaced with unification, and we should be recognizing that it's all part of the same story. And I think that that's what children need to hear, not stories that separate ourselves from ourselves and our communities, but stories that bring us all together. Indigenous stories are extremely important because they are the stories of rootedness. And lately we've had stories that have been disruptive, that have pulled us away from the earth. We need those stories that bind us together. And that's why I think that the solution to the world's problems right now would be to listen to the indigenous people, listen to those people who to a great degree never left Eden. They're still there. They're still part of the sacred. We need to hear those stories, bind ourselves to those stories if they allow us that entry, and then reconnect with the earth and remember that everything is story, everything is narrative. And that's what genetics is all about. And if we allow that to just that process that precedes us and exceeds us to continue, then the story will go on and we'll have a happy ending. I love stories with happy endings, and I hope for the earth that it is a happy ending, but it's not so much the earth surviving. The earth will live on beyond us. It's a question of us as a species surviving. And as a species, what we need is to find ourselves bound and recognize our connection to all of these other stories besides the story of primates.
Well, we've taken a lot of your time. And of course, all of you are busy doing very important, important work. I am particularly fond of this particular group, Storytellers, because I think it throws focus in that word explore from the X part, X, to go out, to go forth, to go out into something, to the plore part, which is to speak out, to say something, to make people aware. Those two words come together to make the word explore, to go forth, see something, to come back, to say something. I wanna thank you all personally for what you do, what you've done through your involvement with the club, and what you represent in terms of the ability for us to speak out, to give voice, to be voice, and through doing that, to bring other people in and expose them to a world they might not have known existed. And with that, I'm going to thank you, and we will conclude. And this has been a fantastic privilege for me over the course of the year to actually speak to almost everyone of the Explorers 50 recipients. And if I had to say anything in closing, it would be to encourage all of you to go to that book, go to the website, find these extraordinary people and communicate with them, because it is an extraordinary group of people that we have assembled and we hope to continue to assemble here at the Explorers Club. So thank you very, very much.